پارلمان اروپا اجلاس رسمی هیئت رابطه با عراق، گزیده ای از شهادت‌های تکان دهنده درباره جنایت ضد انسانی علیه مجاهدان اشرفی با همدستی مارتین کوبلر.
So welcome to the delegation for relations with Iraq. As you will be aware, we have decided to devote the entire meeting today to the crisis in Camp Liberty outside Baghdad. You will all be aware that on the 9th of February there was a vicious missile attack in the early hours of the morning when over 45 Katusha rockets were fired in a tight trajectory into the most densely populated part of Camp Liberty, where people were sleeping. The attack continued for about 15 minutes, highly unusual in terms of terrorist attacks in Iraq, and perhaps Colonel Wesley Martin will explain more about that later. It seems from all the evidence that we have heard, including from an Iraqi military expert who visited the camp and looked at the aftermath of this attack, which killed 8 people, maimed and dismembered 10, and left 90 seriously injured. The Iraqi military expert said that these Katusha rockets must have been fired from around 3.5 kilometers distance, which is well within the security compound that surrounds Camp Liberty, and could only possibly have been done with the full cooperation of the Iraqi government themselves. There is very good intelligence now that the attack was coordinated between the Iranians, the Quds Force, with the coordination and cooperation of the Iraqi government themselves. I have to say to you that it's now 6 weeks since that attack, and to this day, no armored vests or hard hats have been allowed into Camp Liberty. And I have to ask the question, why not? Perhaps Colonel Wes Martin will be able to give us some answers to some of these queries. When we were persuaded in this House to put pressure on the PMOI to move from the relative safety of Camp Ashraf to Camp Liberty, we were told that their security and safety would be absolutely guaranteed. And we had the Americans, the EES, Baroness Ashton herself, and the UN guaranteeing that the safety and security of these people would be of paramount importance and their safety would be guaranteed. We were shown, I remember Aleko Vidal Quadras and I were shown by Special Representative of the United Nations Secretary General, Martin Kobler, a huge book of photographs of Camp Liberty. And our conclusion after seeing these photographs was, well, you know, this looks like a very good place for these people to move to. It's only half a square kilometer, it's very small, but we were assured that there would be a revolving door scenario where the people moving from Ashraf to Liberty would be interviewed, assessed for refugee status, given their refugee status, and then immediately resettled to third countries. I was told by Antonio Guterres himself, the Secretary General of the UNHCR, that this revolving door scenario would operate, and that meanwhile the people would be expected only to stay in Camp Liberty for a very short period of time. I can tell you now that in more than a year, more people have left Camp Liberty in body bags than have been resettled. It is absolutely outrageous. So we were deceived We discovered that the book of photographs which we were shown by Martin Kobler had been photoshopped and doctored with the staff of UNAMI, and you'll hear this from Tara Bonadra. The staff at UNAMI repeatedly told that the quality of the photographs was not good enough and they had to be improved and improved again and again and photoshopped, and all evidence of any deterioration removed from these photographs. We were deceived in that respect. And we then put pressure on the people of Camp Ashraf to move to Camp Liberty, guaranteeing their safety. They have now been viciously attacked, 8 of them dead, and I feel partly responsible for that. And it's strange that before the 3,100 moved from Ashraf to Liberty, there were 17,500 concrete T-walls around Camp Liberty to provide protection for the former American military base from specifically rocket and mortar attacks. All 17,500 T-walls were removed before the first of the Ashraf residents moved into the flimsy cabins that they now have to occupy in this tight half-square kilometer area. And we have to ask why, despite the protests of the people of Camp Ashraf, why were these T-walls removed, leaving them absolutely vulnerable, sitting ducks to attack? So there are some key demands that we now feel inclined to make. First of all, the T-walls have to be restored immediately. There are armoured vests and hard hats which are lying in Camp Ashraf. It would take one small truck to transport them to Camp Liberty. They must immediately, today, be taken to Camp Liberty. Medical equipment must be given access to Camp Liberty. They were denied the right to take their medical equipment from Camp Ashraf to Camp Liberty. Why is the Iraqi government preventing the building of concrete bunkers or shelters where the people could shelter in the case of another attack? Why, when Martin Kobler agreed that the ground space of half a square kilometer could be extended by an additional 2.5 square kilometers, the space is there, it's empty, it's vacant. If he had lived up to his pledge, which he gave face to face in Paris, there would have been fewer casualties on the 9th of February because they would have been more widely dispersed within a 2.5 to 3 kilometer square area. Why has that pledge not been fulfilled? Seriously now, I have to question why Martin Kobler is putting pressure on the residents of Camp Liberty to return to business as usual. He is pleading with the international community to put pressure on them to resume the interview process with UNHCR for their refugee status, as if nothing has happened, as if there had been no attack on the 9th of February, no one had died. Business as usual, let's get back to business. Anyway, I'll give the floor now to Taha Bomedra, former UNAMI senior official from Baghdad.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, everybody. I'm the former advisor of the Special Representative Secretary General, Mr. Kobler, and also the former Chief of the Human Rights Office of UNAMI. I resigned from this position in protest of what I witnessed in both preparing people to be relocated from Camp Ashraf to Camp Liberty, and also over the situation I witnessed in Camp Liberty. Let me tell you from the beginning that I was the person who took the lead in drafting the MOU for the closure of Camp Ashraf and the relocation to Camp Liberty. And I could assure you that the draft report I took the lead in preparing was not the one actually approved by Prime Minister al-Maliki. It was redrafted on the 25th of December on Christmas Day. It was redrafted between Martin Kobler and Faleh Fayyad, the security advisor of the Prime Minister. But let me also tell you the background of this MOU. We did prepare it with the intention and the ultimate objective of disbanding the MEK, the PMO. That was the ultimate objective, is to disband the MEK and expel them from Iraq. That was absolutely the policy of the government of Iraq, and UNAMI was there to implement and help the government of Iraq to implement this policy, and we did it. Now, I came to resign because I find myself as the chief of human rights misleading the international community and misleading the United Nations. How? We drafted the MOU and we have not done anything to effectively protect. What we've done is to close Camp Ashraf, relocate the residents to Camp Liberty. Now, we made two assessments to Camp Liberty before people were transferred there. We made a humanitarian assessment. We made a security assessment. And I'm afraid to say that nobody ever mentioned the security assessment we made in November 2011. That security assessment pointed exactly to vulnerability of the camp from the air, from missile attacks. But we did nothing to protect the residents that will be soon arriving there. On the contrary, the United Nations recruited further 62 Fijian soldiers to reinforce the security of the UN personnel that will be going to Camp Liberty. But nothing was done to reinforce the security or to guarantee safety and security of the Ashrafis. That is the security. Humanitarian assessment, we also did it, and I was in charge of that assessment. I reported that that camp was not fit to accommodate 8,200 people. The humanitarian situation was appalling. Now, my boss, Martin Kobler, asked me to lead in actually doctoring pictures and reports. I was asked to put together appealing, this is the word he used, appealing pictures of the camp. And we made lots of them, about 500 pictures of the camp. And he himself had to actually make the selections, which pictures are sellable to the international community and to the Ashrafis. So we did it. We misled the international community. We misled the EU delegation, which I used to brief every other week. I used to brief them on the human rights situation, not only in Camp Liberty, but also in Iraq in general. So we misled the international community. And I did warn, not only Kobler, but also the UN in general, that the situation is not as presented by Kobler to the international community. Unfortunately, I found no ears to, no ear to listen to me, and I ended up giving up because I thought that I might pass my message better outside the UN than within the UN. I want to also point out that in preparing this process, we had met with the Iranian embassy, and every time we met the Iranian ambassador, we were first had to prepare to present to him accounts. What have we done so far? And he had never been happy. To the extent he refused to give a visa to Kobler to go to Iran. And I tell you, Kobler got a visa to go to Iran on the day the first group of Ashrafis were transferred to Camp Liberty. So that was done. Now, we had numerous meetings with the Iraqi authorities, and they made public announcements that they will not be bound by the human rights standards of UNAMI or the United Nations. And that is on public record. Every time we discuss the humanitarian situation, we were told, forget about the UN standards, we are not giving VIP treatment to people who are terrorists. Now, when we decided to finally move on, and in order to convince the international community that everything is fine, the UN hired an expert, shelter expert. They brought him from Ethiopia to visit Camp Liberty and to certify that Camp Liberty is up to the humanitarian standards required. The shelter expert refused. I was with him. I was with him. We discussed in detail the situation on the ground, and he issued a report, a draft report, saying that he cannot certify. So Kobler decided to do without him. And believe me, this was done at serious money, taxpayers' money, EU money, US as well. So this serious money was spent just to bring somebody to make a report, and then that report was dismissed, and Kobler issued his own report. And we finally convinced everybody that things are up to the standards. And I faced Kobler face to face. I asked him, how can we do that? How can we behave? We are the UN. We have values to live up to. Kobler will tap me on the shoulder and say, be positive. Be positive meaning forget about human rights, forget about humanitarian standards. We need to do a job. We need to close Camp Ashraf. We need to eradicate these people. That's the mission. That's what UNAMI is doing. Now, in my job as a human rights officer, I always addressed the Iraqis. And I was also advising the Iraqis in my capacity as a human rights, chief of the human rights office. I always advised them, I requested that the humanitarian standard set by the U.S. Army before they handed over the camp to the Iraqis. I said to them, there is a standard about medical treatments, about the food, water, electricity, all the, there are these standards set by the U.S. Army, and we need to keep that standard going. Because after all the supplies that the Ashrafis receive, they pay for them. They pay for it at a more expensive price than what is the price in Iraq. Most of their utilities, most of their needs are imported from Kuwait. And you will ask me, why they import from Kuwait? It's because there is a legislation in Iraq to make it a criminal offense to cooperate with the Ashrafis. So anybody, organization or individual, who is caught cooperating with the Ashrafis will be prosecuted under the Anti-Terrorist Act. And this is why they resort to importing things at a very high cost. But yet, I hear that the government tries to justify that they are doing all they could in order to facilitate their life. They are denying them to introduce any improvements in the camp. When I asked them, why do you do that? The reply was, we don't want to make their life comfortable because they never leave Iraq if we make their life comfortable. So we have to make it, and it's a quote, unbearable. So life has to be unbearable, and therefore they will be forced to leave. But let me also mention that there are about 200 arrest warrants against these people. These arrest warrants, some of them issued in Tehran, others issued in Baghdad. These arrest warrants, they target the leadership of the Ashrafis. And the whole process of closing Camp Ashraf and sending them to Camp Liberty is in order to actually arrest the leadership. And the whole problem for Iran and Iraq is the leadership, it's not the rest of the population. So once they arrest, they transfer them to Camp Liberty. In fact, we were expecting that in the process of the transfer, there will be a chaotic situation where the normal residents will sort of just disappear. And then, in that chaos, the government would move in to arrest the leadership. But it did not happen the way the government wished, and therefore no Ashrafi has deserted the camp, and therefore they could not sort of make it so obvious that the operation is in fact targeting the arrest of the leadership. Now, I could tell you, and I have lengthy discussion with the Iraqis, that the security situation is not going to stop there. We witnessed the act of 9th of February, and that was not unpredictable. We knew it's going to happen. And we also know that right now that further attacks will happen. And it's organized in Baghdad. The government of Al-Maliki is responsible about that. I could tell you that I discussed this. And I was always told that these people are criminals, they're terrorists, those who have blood on their hands, they have to be arrested and extradited, and those who don't have blood on their hands will just take their way out and disappear in the air. That's the plan. Now, I'm really sorry to sort of find myself in a situation where all the values I lived up to when I joined the United Nations, I find myself facing exactly the opposite. When as a chief of human rights, I was advocating that nobody should ever held, arrested, or held for a crime without the due process of law. The United Nations, UNAM in particular, did everything it did so far on the presumption that these people are guilty. I opposed to this presumption. I asked Kobler, you cannot do that. He tells me, be positive. And be positive, it means just keep your eyes closed. Now, the other presumption of innocence. The United Nations, including, I say here, including the UNHCR, presume that these people are guilty and therefore they do not, they are not eligible for the refugee status. And this is what is delaying the process. And let me remind you that a similar process took place in Camp Mahmoud. You all know Camp Mahmoud. It's a place for the PKK refugees. Be finishing, and I have to tell you, those who were processed at the, I think, 1,500, they were not adjudicated as refugees of concern to the international community. Once you are adjudicated as a refugee, you have the right to freedom of movement, you have the right to travel documents, you have the right to education, you have the right, you have all the rights of the refugees. The Ashrafis do not have this right, and yet the UNHCR is keeping quiet on this issue. Worse than that, the UNHCR, if you look at clause 7 of the MOU signed by Kobler and the government of Iraq, clause 7 is it strips the UNHCR from its very mandate. It said that the Iraqi government will allow the UNHCR to undertake the RSD process, but will not be bound by its outcome. Meaning the government of Iraq will not recognize the refugee status of these people, even though recognized by UNHCR. And yet, we do not report on this. I'm finishing. I just want to tell the audience. The report in Security Council of the Secretary General, I'll tell you how this report was prepared, and it's a normal procedure. Every SRSG, every special representative of the Secretary General prepares his own chapter to be integrated in the Secretary General's report to the Security Council. So what was quoted, the three chapters quoted about Ashraf, presented by Kobler, they were prepared in Baghdad by Kobler himself. So, here again, misleading the Security Council. And this is very dangerous, I'm afraid. I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Tara Bamedra. Could I give the floor now to Colonel Wesley Martin?
Ladies and gentlemen, I appreciate the opportunity to be here. And also, Mr. Stevenson, I really appreciate you allowing us to speak. The situation throughout Iraq has deteriorated. Nuri al-Maliki, 10 years ago, he was a street vendor in Damascus. Now, he has become, in all essence, a dictator of Iraq. He has surrounded himself with North Somali security forces. He has all kinds of agendas, none of them for the benefit of Iraq. One of the forces he is starting to surround himself with is this Iraqi Hezbollah. This attack was coordinated with Ahmadinejad and Nuri al-Maliki so that the Quds force could come in here and do this. Militias, and the Iraqi Hezbollah stepped up and said, oh, well, we did it. No, they didn't. Precision of this report, this attack, had to come from within Camp Liberty, Camp Victory, Camp Slayer compound area, and I guarantee you there was a spotter up on the hill. Long before I was a colonel in the military police, I was a private in the artillery. I learned how to call fire. I knew how to get precision fire. And militias do not launch attacks for 15 minutes. They fire two or three rockets and then quickly vacate. This went on 15 minutes with precision accuracy, the adjustment of fire coming from Signal Hill. I gave as many copies as I had of this report. I asked you to go through it, if you could. And take it with you when you have a chance and go ahead and analyze it. Please bear in mind one critical thing. When the Americans, and I lived on Camp Liberty when I was in the J3 of detention operations, those were residents, those were trailers put in there so we could have a place to sleep at night. We did not stay inside the compound. We went outside every morning and we worked for 19 hours a day. Then we came back to the compound. They were just places to sleep. Now, in a very small fraction of Camp Liberty, you have 3,100 people compiled in there. And there's all kinds of threats towards them, and they're artificial threats. The T-walls that were removed, that is so when the next rocket attack occurs, there can be more maximum kill going on. Colonel Sadiq is a war criminal. I compare him to General Graziani of the Italian military in the 1920s in Libya, and all the atrocities being allowed to go on. I thank the Spanish court for properly identifying him for his criminal activities, and this needs to be taken by all nations to include the United States. The United States has been wrong in its handling of Iran since 1953 with the CIA-supported coup. We supported a very brutal dictator, the Shah. There's a chance of democracy. Unfortunately, it failed. Khomeini came to power. The United States has not properly dealt with that problem since. Madeleine Albright decided in 1997 to turn them into a terrorist organization to appease the Iranian government was totally wrong. Louis Freeh, former director of the FBI, was in charge of the FBI at that time. He stood up to her and he said, "You're wrong for doing it." Unfortunately, it went forward. European nations followed suit. Canadian government followed suit. I was glad to see the European governments pull them off the list. Again, the most important thing is security. Get those T-walls back. Get the bunkers in. Let them have sandbags. Let them have proper food and nutrition. Right now, and it's in my report, they have disease. They have all kinds of problems going on. The black water sewage tanks have broke. They're in the rain season. All that sewage mixed in with the ground. And what is happening? Nothing. Except now they're going through pretty nice weather. In another month, it's going to bake. The sand fleas, the flies are going to be out. Disease is going to be rampant. And like I say, their immune systems are already depleted. They're exhausted. I definitely welcome a lot of questions. I would like to close by pointing out something. When I was at the Canadian Embassy and other times, I've been accused of doing this for financial gain. I am not paid a single penny. I never have been paid a single penny to speak, to write, or any other type of work I've done. We promised these people protected person status. In the military, the American military and all militaries operate under three words, duty, honor, country. Unfortunately, we have violated all three of those words when we revoked the protected person status and we turned our allies over to the pro-Iranian Maliki government. But a lot of lies have been stated about this organization. I've done the research, I've done the homework, I've done the study, I've been able to separate the lies, and I find most of the misinformation about this organization comes from the Ministry of Intelligence out of Iran. Also, let's look at the future stability of the Middle East. We see meltdown in Iraq, we see meltdown in Syria, we see meltdown everywhere. One of the biggest sources of the problems is the current Iranian government. And yet, Western Europe, Canada, and the United States especially, has not figured out how to deal with this government. Appeasement is not a way to deal. The last reason, wherever I travel, I get to see the youth of the Iranian families in Europe, Canada, and the United States. I see outstanding young people, very dedicated to their families, growing up in democracy, and I can't help but think of what greatness can come out of the Middle East if stability is brought into that region. Ladies and gentlemen, I will back down and I'll be available for questions.
And when we talk about the safety and security of the people in Camp Liberty being entrusted to the Iraqi government, you should know that the Iraqi government appointed that self-same Colonel Sadat to be in charge of security and safety of the residents of Camp Liberty. That was the absolute and most obvious example of the true intentions of the Iraqi government to the residents of Camp Liberty. They even tried to bring him here to speak to this delegation, and in fact he was subsequently arrested in Paris under the orders of the Spanish courts, who have an indictment for murder against him. So, you know, for the EES to say security and safety of the people in Camp Liberty is not our responsibility. That has been entrusted to the Iraqi government. It's quite frankly ludicrous. Absolutely ludicrous.
I ask you one more legal point. If you have said that it's a clear intention of Iraqi government to make the life of them unbearable.
Yes?
Is it not equal to mass torturing? United Nations are still against torturing, I suppose. Is that issue not arised? It is a torturing until they will be out, or that.
Mr. Bernardo.
In fact, we have on record the National Security Advisor, Alobai, the one, up to, he was National Security Advisor until 2009, and he is the one who received Camp Ashraf from when it was handed over from the Americans. He said to the letter, we will make their life unbearable. This is on record, and it's in the public domain. Second, the current National Security Advisor, Falah Fayyad, he also said on the 28th of September, it's on the UN record, 28th of September 2011, we had a meeting with him in Amman, in Jordan. And he told us in the meeting, in the presence of UNHCR, that we will not treat these people with the standards you are advocating because they are terrorists. Again, this is on the record. And all throughout my interaction with the Iraqi government, because I'm supposed as a UN member of the staff, I'm also advising the government of Iraq. And I did warn them many times when things went wrong. I told them what you're doing is wrong. And I always received the reply that they will not facilitate their life in the country. They have to make sure that they will not feel comfortable in Iraq, and therefore they will leave. I was the person who did the body count for the two attacks. The two attacks, I was face to face on the 8th of April 2011 in the house of Falah Fayyad, the National Security Advisor, on a Friday morning, because I wanted the attack to stop immediately. So we went into his house early in the morning, and he replied that there is nothing happening. I told him there is, right now there is an attack. At the time, 8 o'clock on Friday, the 8th, there was 22 dead already. I said to him, please do stop it. He said, there is nothing happening. And yet, I'm in contact with Ashraf, and I know the attack is still ongoing. So he could have stopped it. But yet, it's a long story, I will not dwell on it, but just to tell you that the criminal intentions were there. Thank you.
The most important question now is to try to protect 3,100 people. And they are under the protection of the international law. They are under the protection of the United Nations. They are under the responsibility of the Iraq people. There have been more than 60 people who were killed, 100 of people who were injured, and somebody must be responsible for that. And the European Union really has a strong links with the Iraqi government, and I think the European Union has to react in a proper way. And I'm afraid, after listening to the people who is here, the most important thing is how we can guarantee the security of that people and who is going to respond for the debt which has been produced. And we cannot accept this kind of situations. We have partners and we have to try to express in a very strong way the reaction and the position of the European Union, which is to protect. And this is, it must be our very firm commitment, Mr. President. Thank you very much.
Thank you all for your attendance.